Quintus Labienus, defected to Parthia, died in battle in 39 BCE. The son of the much better known Titus Labienus, Quintus was probably in his early 20s when his father was killed in combat at the Battle of Munda in 45 BCE. When Caesar was assassinated the following year, the younger Labienus sided with the assassins and served with Brutus and Cassius. It is not entirely clear whether the younger Labienus fought at Philippi and then traveled east, or whether he had been dispatched before the battle to serve as the ambassador to Parthia for the Pompeian faction. At any rate, after Brutus and Cassius were crushed by the Caesarians at Philippi, Labienus proved to be as implacable a foe to the legacy of Caesar as his father had been to the man himself. He joined Parthia and served as a general. Whether he was trying to revitalize the lost cause of the conservative faction in the Senate, seek out a new position for himself in the Roman world, or become a major player in Parthian politics is far from clear given the dearth of information that we have about Quintus's career. Later, Mark Antony took command of the Roman East, famously settling with Cleopatra in Alexandria and leaving Syria in the hands of an obscure subordinate named Lucius Decidius Saxa. The Parthian king Orades II dispatched his son Pacorus and Quintus Labienus to take advantage of Antony's lax preparations. Labienus and Prince Pacorus I took the whole Parthian army and invaded Roman territory in 40 BCE. Ostensibly, these troops were liberating Rome from the tyranny of the Caesarian faction. Labienus and Saxa clashed near Antioch, resulting in a great victory for Labienus. After that, the two armies diverged, with Labienus pursuing and killing Saxa somewhere in Cilicia, allowing him to occupy Roman Syria and parts of Palestine, while Pacorus conquered southwards all the way to Palestine's border with Egypt. Labienus's victory over Saxa additionally resulted in the capture of yet more Roman standards to add to the collection that the Parthians had started following their great victory at Carrhae in 53. Later, Augustus would use negotiation to recover the Roman standards lost by Crassus and Saxa. The conquest by Labienus and Pacorus reclaimed most of the old western territories of the Achaemenid Persian Empire, with the exceptions of Thrace, Macedon, Egypt, and Cyprus. Labienus's advance was through Asia Minor, and it was swift. He was hailed as imperator by many while he was marching through these eastern provinces. While his tenure and administration over this region was brief, Labienus did have the time to mint a coin bearing his name and image to try to legitimate his cause. However, the tide turned swiftly when Antony's general Publius Ventidius Bassus took command. Ventidius landed on the coast of Asia Minor with a force that was larger than Labienus's army, which then forced the Pompeian general to retreat to Cilicia. There, Labienus received significant reinforcements from Pacorus, which presumably included enough additional cavalry to give his army a significant edge in that regard over the Roman forces in the region. Now confident of having the edge on Ventidius, Labienus confronted him at an unknown spot in Cilicia, and the two engaged in what has come to be known as the Battle of the Cilician Gates. The experienced Ventidius knew that he was at a disadvantage against the superior Parthian cavalry, so he positioned his infantry on top of a hill, kept his cavalry close to protect his flanks, and waited. Labienus was planning to advance, but his Parthian cavalry was overeager for combat and thought that the battle would be an easy one. Advancing without Labienus and his infantry, his cavalry pushed headlong and right uphill into Ventidius's hands. Ventidius charged downhill and his legionaries were able to smash and rout the Parthian mounted archers, who were lightly armed, and thereby defeat the feared cataphracts by driving the panicked horse archers right into them. Left isolated, Quintus Labienus and his small force of exiled Roman infantry faced an inevitable defeat. Labienus attempted to withdraw, but his men decided to surrender and defect back to Rome, so Labienus was taken prisoner, and swiftly executed. Despite Quintus Labienus' close relationship with the king and crown prince of the Parthian Empire, he apparently did not command anywhere near the level of respect with either the rank and file of the Parthian cavalry, nor with the commanders themselves, since they did not wait for Labienus to join them in their assault against Ventidius' position. It is also possible that his command authority was limited to the infantry. While Labienus' men must have been loyal to the memory of Caesar's assassins to have gone into exile in Parthia, perhaps Labienus' harsh treatment of Saxa and living off the land with men from a foreign empire's army had proven to be too distasteful for them to tolerate. More simply, they may have just realized that a single defeat was enough to render Labienus' cause null and void, and yielded to their own sense of self-preservation. Following this defeat, the remaining Parthians made an attempt to hold up the Roman advance, but they were defeated by Ventidius' vanguard at Amanus Pass. Labienus' defeat and death in Asia Minor at the hands of Ventidius in 39 BCE, and the subsequent failure to contain the Romans, spooked Pacorus so much that he retreated into Parthia to regroup before entering Syria again in 38, where he met his end. Like his father Titus, Quintus Labienus seemed to be a man with great personal valor and a solid set of military skills, whose choice of associations could not have possibly been worse. The younger Labienus was in some ways following the tradition of Sertorius, though unlike Sertorius, who could be made out to be a champion of the people, or at least a separatist, Quintus Labienus's is a case of undeniable treason. Much of the reason for his obscurity in the historical record is possibly because he first betrayed and then inflicted great hardships and humiliation on his homeland while promoting the political aims of Rome's chief rival,